गुड मॉर्निंग बंसर।
हेलो।
यस सर, मॉर्निंग।
या वी कैन स्टार्ट नाउ सर।
या या यू कैन स्टार्ट आई थिंक। गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल ऑफ यू। हेलो।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
अरे गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
या या थैंक यू वेरी मच। एंड टुडे वी ऑल गैदर्ड हियर फॉर द टुडे वर्कशॉप ऑन दिस लाइटर देन एयर व्हीकल्स डिजाइन एंड from basics of the this particular system by Professor Rajkumar S. Pant from IIT Bombay Aerospace Engineering Department. And it's my pleasure and also I'm very lucky to be here on this dais sharing with Pant sir. And also we are very fortunate to hear him and also gain the knowledge on this particular lighter than air vehicles. And as a formality, it is not required, but I would like to give a brief introduction of Rajkumar S. Pant sir for all of your information and knowledge. And Professor Rajkumar S. Pant has bachelor's, master's and PhD degrees in aerospace engineering. His areas of specialization include aircraft conceptual design, air transportation, and optimization. He has been a member of faculty of Aerospace Engineering Department at Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, since December 1989. So, a very long experience he is having. And
hello.
Hello. Are you getting my voice?
Yeah, yeah. Yes, yeah. Yes.
Professor Pant is an alumnus of College of Aeronautics, Grenfell University, UK, where he earned his PhD under Commonwealth Scholarship Scheme, and IIT Madras, where he did his Master's in Aeronautical Engineering. He has also worked for 5 years in Hindustan Aeronautics Limited, HAL, in the Design and Engineering Department at Kanpur, about for 3.5 years, and plus at Nasik, around 1.5 years in these divisions. And in 2002, he set up an lighter-than-air LTA systems laboratory at IIT Bombay, which has undertaken several R&D and consultancy projects related to design, development, and demonstration of LTA systems. Since 2007, he has been an international member of AIAA's Lighter Than Air Technical Committee and was the chairperson for 2014 to 16 period. He has published and presented around 240 scientific papers, of which more than 180 are in journals and international conferences. He has also visited several top-ranking institutes and universities all over the world. And Professor Pant was a visiting faculty at Department of Mechanical and Aerospace Engineering at Nanyang Technical University in 2016 and Department of Aerospace and Ocean Engineering at Virginia Polytechnic Institute and State University in 2010-11. And he was a visiting researcher at Instituto Tecnologia di Aeronautica, Brazil in 2012, Texas A&M University in 2011, Cambridge University in 2008, and Imperial College London in 2006. In 2002, 2012, he was appointed as a special visiting researcher under the Science Without Borders program at the Brazilian government for a 3-year project related to design and development of hybrid lighter than air systems. Professor Pant was honored with the D.P. Joshi Excellent Teacher Award in 2014 in recognition of his merit, achievements, and enthusiasm for teaching and making a lasting impression on students. In 2019, he was felicitated by Institute of Engineers, IE, India, as an eminent engineering personality in aerospace engineering. Recently, he received special recognition in Academic Excellence Faculty National Category Award by Institute of Engineers, India, as part of fourth biennial international conference on nascent technologies in engineering held in January 2021. So like this, there are a lot of achievements. These are few to read out for your information. And we are all very fortunate to be here, to hear Dr. Pant sir, and he will be starting the day one session, first session of the day one. And basically we'll be basics of these air vehicles, indoor air vehicles, conceptual designs, what is the design concepts, and how to really work out hand practice, means the hands-on practice of the design, maybe by the second day tomorrow. So after gaining the basic things from him today, so you can also practice. So I request all the participants to be attending all the sessions without missing, and gain the knowledge and also enjoy while learning, and also interact whenever you have any doubts. No, Professor Pant is a very interactive person, and he will always like to share the knowledge with these young minds. So take the benefit of that, and I request all to sincerely and attend these workshop sessions on both the days without missing. Thank you very much. And now I think it's time to hand over this dais to Professor Pant sir for continuing his first session. Yes. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay.
For honoring our request and making available yourself for this particular session on these 2 days. Thank you very much.
Very good. Thank you so much. A very warm welcome to all the participants. As you know, we have already exceeded the number 100, and therefore,
yes,
I have shared the link. So there are a few people, I think, who are also signed in on the YouTube.
Yes.
So
we also forward that to other groups so that they can watch on YouTube.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Yeah. Right. So, friends, this is a 2-day event. The way we have planned it is that on the first day, we are going to give you some basic background introduction. And also, we will go through the sizing procedure that is generally followed for designing indoor remotely controlled airships. And I will end the day in the evening by giving you an overview of previous projects that have been done by students like you, so that we can get motivated to take up similar projects. This workshop is an outcome of a discussion that we had about 2-3 weeks ago, when some students of your department showed interest in designing and fabricating an outdoor airship. But during the discussion with them, I advised them that if it is the first project that they are doing, and that too on a limited budget, it is better to first learn how to make indoor airships, and then subsequently you can go ahead. So the way in which we are going to work is as follows. I have shown you the rough timeline. We have already spent 10 minutes from the first lecture in the introduction. But there will be a 10-minute break at the end of each session, and then there is going to be a 1-hour break for lunch. Okay, so that is the system we are going to follow. As Professor Ramana mentioned, I would prefer if this interaction is actually an interaction and not a lecture, because lectures are very boring. Interactions are more exciting. So whenever you have a doubt, I am giving you permission to unmute yourself and start speaking. Remember that when I am making this presentation, I am not able to see. I'm not able to see the audience. Okay, I can only see the screen. So if you raise your hand or if you do something, I will not be able to see. So the only way is to maybe just unmute yourself and start speaking. Okay, is it all right? Shall we start now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so we will start with the first presentation, which is on the introduction to the lighter than air systems. Okay, so I'll proceed ahead. First question that comes to our mind is, what exactly are lighter than air systems? So can somebody start the proceeding by answering this question? Anybody can answer, what exactly are lighter than air systems?
Hello, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
So lighter than air systems, we use lighter than air gases to give them lift power. And using that power, we made a product in which we just add maneuverability and use them as an aircraft.
Okay. So you have used a lot of words like power, etc., but there is no power here. Remember, as an engineer, you should know that power is something different. So LTA systems, basically what you said is right, that these are systems which are ones in which the principal lifting force is coming because of the buoyancy. And notice I am saying the principal lifting force, I am not saying the entire lifting force, because when there is relative motion between an LTA system and air, there is going to be some lift generated, which is called as dynamic lift. But even when these systems are stationary, you still get some lift because of the buoyancy, and that is called as a static lift. And generally, when we design the LTA systems, we try to ensure that the static lift is enough to overcome the mass. So therefore, we don't need dynamic lift. But when dynamic lift is there, you cannot avoid it. It will be there. Okay. Now, buoyancy, as you all remember from your school, is a tendency of a body to float or to rise when submerged in a fluid. And it is basically due to the force which is exerted on the body. This is the person, the gentleman called Archimedes, who was the person to discover the phenomena of buoyancy. And this is how he discovered the phenomena. While enjoying his bath in the bathtub in the morning, he realized he was actually trying to solve a problem. And it was there in his mind. So while having this, taking his bath in the bathtub, he got this brainwave about buoyancy. So any gas or mixture of gases whose density is less than air can be termed as an LTA gas. And the most common LTA gases are hydrogen and helium. Hydrogen typically gives you a lifting capacity of around 1.135 kilograms per cubic meter. And helium gives you a lifting capacity of around 1.058 kg per meter cube. That means if you have a balloon of 1 meter cube volume, and if you fill it with helium, you will get a vertical force of 1.058 kg. If you subtract from that the self-weight of the balloon, that much payload or that much equipment can be carried onto that balloon. We all know that hydrogen is the best LTA gas, lightest, but there are serious problems with its flammability. However, as I will try to show you today, if you are careful and if you take the proper precautions, you should be able to work safely with hydrogen. The other option we have is helium, which is the second best gas. But the problem with helium is that it is very, very expensive. And it is not easily available. It's a very rare gas and also not affordable. But I have a question here. are these the only two gases available for you for filling in an LTA envelope? Or do you have any other choices also? Can somebody please answer?
Yes, sir. We have some other options like ammonia, carbon monoxide, but they don't have much lifting capacity. Hello, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. Now we are getting.
There was a slight problem. I think because of the overload, because we have working on full capacity. So okay. Because of that, I think there was some issue. But fortunately, we are back. So
I think all videos, anyhow, you didn't on videos of students.
No video, sir. It is because of the load. There are
people. Yeah, but that's why that's correct. Yes.
So okay. It's okay, and there could be some problem also with the internet connectivity. So that could also be the reason. So nothing to worry. We will just go back and we will resume from where we were. So this was the first man-made LTA system which most of you must have studied in your school. Two brothers, Montgolfier brothers. Okay, they were the ones to make a paper balloon and make it fly. Later on, they made a cloth balloon. Now, the two categories of systems are the lighter than air systems and the heavier than air systems. And what I have done is I have shown in green color the advantages and in black, red color the disadvantages. So we notice that there are three red bands for heavier than air systems about which we study in our college. And there are three green bands for the lighter than air systems, which we are going to study today. So, as regards the LTA systems, I already mentioned to you that you have aerostatic and dynamic lift. But the main reason why they are coming back is that they are highly fuel efficient. And they also have less complex operating mechanisms. On the other hand, the heavier than air systems do not have aerostatic lift. They need to fly at certain minimum speed before they can be operated. So can you tell me what is the name of that speed? What is the minimum speed at which you have to fly a heavier than air system? What do we call that speed?
Sir, Vstall?
Vstall is actually a dangerous number because we have to have we normally fly at a speed called as VMC, V minimum control. That is slightly above the Vstall because you also need to control the aircraft. So you are right. Every aircraft has a specified stalling speed, and you have to definitely fly at a reasonable margin above that, generally 15 to 20% higher than the stalling speed. But LTA systems can be operated even at zero speed. We all know that the STA systems or the heavier than air systems are fuel inefficient. They consume large amount of fuel, and they are also very complex. Whereas LTS systems, as you will see, are much less complex. And hence, they are very much liked by students who want to work to make some flying systems. But then we come to the advantages of HTS systems. They are fast and they are less susceptible to weather changes. These are the two areas where the LTS systems are very, very bad compared to aircraft. So can you tell me what is the fastest speed for a manned aircraft that you know? How fast can an aircraft fly?
Like most of the aircrafts, fighter jets work at supersonic speeds, but there are some who also have done hypersonic cruising.
No. Do you know any aircraft which can fly hypersonic with human being on board?
SR-71.
SR-71, correct. So what is the Mach number it flies, maximum Mach number?
Sir,
Mach 16. Number 3.3.
Yeah, it's around 3.5, correct. So compared to that, if you look at the fastest LTS system, what do you think is the highest Mach number of an LTS system or an airship? How fast can an airship fly? Let us say Mach number wise. What do you think? Take a guess.
0.1 to 0.2.
Yes, sir. Maybe 0.3.
0.15, 0.2. That is the maximum Mach number you can expect on an airship. And also, the biggest reason why we do not see them, despite being so good, is that they are only able to operate in good weather conditions. Okay, and that is why I am suggesting that you should try your airship first with an indoor system, because outdoor airships are going to be very difficult to manage. They will be very difficult to manage, especially for the newcomers. Okay, so if you look at conventional LTS system, there are three types. There is an airship, there is an aerostat, and there is a hot air balloon. Now, on the extreme right is a hot air balloon, which has no directional control, no control surfaces, no engine. It just has a 1 degree of freedom, which is to go up and down, and then the wind will take it wherever it wants. So that is very good for adventure and maybe even for certain applications, but mostly I don't think we should worry about it. As a scientific equipment, it is not really very capable. In the middle, we see an aerostat. Now, an aerostat is basically a very interesting word. It is an oxymoron. Those of you who have studied English, do you know what is the meaning of oxymoron? Can someone help me with the meaning of oxymoron and give an example? What is an oxymoron in English? Well, you can do it. Yeah.
Like, sir, not a definition, but they have problem with oxygen.
Problem with?
Oxygen.
Oxygen. No. There is no oxygen here.
It's figure of speech, sir.
Correct. What does it mean?
Self-contradicting words.
Like?
Contradictory terms, sir.
Like? Example? Any example? Okay, I'll give you an example. The presentation that you are seeing is terribly good. This is a contradiction. The word terrible and good are coming together. Correct? Similarly, an aerostat is an oxymoron in aviation. An aerostat is an aircraft that remains stationary while being deployed. How can an aircraft remain stationary? Because of the LTA gas. So an aerostat is basically an aerodynamically shaped, we'll see about it. Okay, we'll see about it. Right? So the two major LTA systems are aerostats and airships. In my next presentation, I'm going to talk about airships. So let me remove them right now and let us look at aerostats. Okay, so in the next few minutes, we are going to quickly look at aerostats. You please confirm to me that my PPT is visible, because I don't know. I'm just clicking on links. Okay.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay. So let us look at AeroStax. Basically, it is an aerodynamically shaped tethered LTA platform. The word tethered basically means anything that is connected to the ground with a cable. So an aerostat is a stationary LTA system. That's why I don't call it LTA vehicle. I call it as an LTA platform. And on this platform, you can mount any equipment. It could be a communication equipment. It could be surveillance equipment or anything else that you want to carry at a high altitude. It could be a weather sensor, wind sensor, whatever, aerial photography equipment. So the desired feature of an aerostat is that it should have a high payload capacity. What do you mean by payload? Can somebody explain the meaning of the word payload? In aerospace engineering, what is meant by payload?
Sir, it is the mass of that we need to carry, be it a cargo or passengers or any other system that we need to transport from one place to another. It is considered as a payload.
Okay, so an aircraft has an engine. Is that a part of the payload?
No, sir. We generally not consider it as a payload. When talking about aircrafts, we generally consider our payload as the passenger's weight and the luggage weight.
Correct.
We don't consider the structural weight of the aircraft.
Correct. So payload is something for which the operator gets paid. Okay? A load for which you are getting paid. When you carry passengers, when you carry cargo, when you carry any equipment, you are getting paid for it. And that is why it's called as a payload. So anything that the user gives you to carry is payload. Any equipment that you provide in the aircraft for your own requirement, like engine, like seats, etc., they are not payload. Okay. So a good aerostat should be able to carry a large amount of payload. It should be able to maintain the position at a specified altitude, because normally the payload is supposed to be deployed at a particular altitude. For example, if you have a communication equipment, they might say that, okay, I want this equipment to be at 100 meter altitude. Now, if the aerostat brings it down to 20 meter or 10 meter or 50 meters, it is not good. It's not desirable. If the requirement is 100 meters, it should remain 100 meters. And the third thing is that it should have stability in the ambient wind conditions. Okay. What do you mean by ambient wind? What is meant by ambient wind?
Sir, the normal wind conditions in a sunny day or normal atmosphere.
Correct. Prevailing in the atmosphere. You have no control on this. Okay. Ambient wind basically is the wind that you will encounter during the deployment. You cannot say that the ambient wind will be assumed to be zero. It will be what it will be, depending on the weather conditions at the location. So whatever be the wind, of course, there are limits, especially with the LTA system, there are limits to how much ambient wind it can handle. But whatever the ambient wind it can handle, it should remain stable in that condition. So can somebody explain to me what is meant by stability? When will you call a system as stable?
It has a tendency to come back its original position.
Yes, very good. I'm very happy that you use the word tendency, because it may not come back to the same position. It may actually exceed the position and then again it will come back. The tendency, the initial tendency, but you forgot one thing, that tendency of the system to come back to the original undisturbed position on its own without any action by the pilot. Because if you bring it to the condition by deflecting a control surface, that is called control. That is not stability. Stability means up. It should happen on its own. Okay. The tendency of the system should be to come back to the original undisturbed condition. Okay. Now, the shape of the envelope affects all these requirements, and they will also be there for airships. So when we discuss about airship envelope, you will realize the importance of the shape. Here is an example of a small relocatable aerostat system, which is mounted on a pickup truck. This particular aerostat is from a company, and it can carry around 10 to 15 pounds, which is approximately 5 to 7 kgs. It can go to a height of around 700. There are specifications given there. And notice that there is a speed limit given as 45 knots, which means that it cannot withstand the wind, or it is not designed to withstand the wind more than 45 knots, and only one person is required to operate it from the ground. Okay. So this is a small aerostat system. And what do you notice in the aerostat? So can you tell me what all do you see in this picture quickly? What are the components of the aerostat that you see in this picture? Please tell me what all do you see?
Sir, we can see the fins.
We can see the fins. So why do we have the fins?
We use them, basically we use them for stability purposes. Or exactly. Yes.
Yeah, only
for. Or we can use it to either maneuver from.
No maneuvering. No maneuver. Aerostats cannot be maneuvered. Aerostats have control surfaces. They have only stabilizing surfaces. Okay. So in aerostats, fins are. Only for stability. That's right. Anything else you observe about the shape, about the way it is put up?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
It has tier, the envelope has teardrop shape.
Yes, the envelope has a very good shape. No, not only for stability. Teardrop shape is also required for lower drag.
Yes, sir.
Okay, what else do you see? Do you see some black colored thing mounted somewhere here? What is that? What is that black colored thing where my mouse is there right now, if you can see it? That is a payload. That is a payload, whatever it is. That is a payload. So it's a very small payload. Of course, it's a very small aerostat. Okay. Right. Then do you see that there is a cable attaching to the bottom? Can you see in the picture a black colored cable here?
Yes, sir.
That is a tether. That is a tether. Okay. Right. So this is what a typical aerostat is. It contains an envelope, which is the gas or the helium chamber, which contains the lifting gas. Then you have a small air balloon inside in some aerostats, which are meant for pressure and buoyancy control. Then you have tail fins on the back for static and dynamic stability. So here I'd like to know, some of you might know this, what is meant by static and dynamic stability? How are they different? Can someone tell me what is meant by static stability and what is meant by dynamic stability? Come on, you should be knowing this. If you have done a course on stability and control, I'm sure you must know about static and dynamic stability, the difference between them.
Sir, basically static stability will deal with how initially the aerostat will respond to an imbalance. Whereas dynamic stability will deal with how it responds over the time.
Very good, very good. Dynamic stability static stability tells you about the intention. Dynamic stability tells you about the reality, what actually happens. So many students have signed up for this course. That is the intention. But those who have actually registered, actually come and attended the class, that is the dynamic stability. That means they are really interested. Okay. So similarly, static stability is the initial intention. Dynamic stability is the final outcome. Very good. I'm very happy that you are answering the question so nicely and making it interactive for me also. The tether is a cable that attaches to the ground. Now, in the previous photograph, I showed you a straight tether. The photograph showed a straight line. But in this particular figure, you see a tether to be a curved line. So why is it so?
Sir, it is somewhat similar to what we do while we fly kites.
Very good. People in Gujarat are very, very happy with kites. I know, because of Uttaran and all that. Correct. You are right. So you have observed that the tether occupies a particular profile because of the action of the wind and the weight of the tether. Correct. That is right. That is right. So in the previous one, why was it straight? And here, why is it curved? Because in the previous one, maybe the wind was very low or the tension in the cable was very high. In this case, maybe the tether is heavy and winds are large. That's why it is taking this particular shape. But never mind. basically the tether is required to attach the envelope to the ground. That is the purpose of a tether. Okay. And as I mentioned to you, you can have all kinds of payloads. In this case, I have shown the payload to be mounted on the bottom of the envelope, but the payload can also be mounted in small pieces all over the aerostat, as I will show you in some pictures. And then one important thing that you require on the ground is winching and mooring. So can someone guess the difference between winching and mooring? What is winching? What is mooring? Take a guess. What comes to your mind when you hear the word winching and mooring?
Sir, is it somewhat similar to attaching to a fixed station, something?
Correct. So mooring basically means attaching the balloon or the envelope to a fixed station on the ground. And winching is a mechanism to allow it to go up and down. So sometimes there is a motor which will be operated to allow the winch, allow the aerostat to go up and down. So winching means raising and lowering. Mooring means holding when not in use on the ground. So we need these two stations. Even for airships, we need something like this. Of course, there is no winching in airships, but there is mooring, and I'll talk to you about that. Okay. Question is, why should we go for aerostats when we have aircraft? So again, looking at the reds and the greens, so the aircraft can work in bad weather and the aircraft can achieve high speeds, but it has massive fuel consumption. The endurance can be only about 16 hours and it requires a terrain like airport or flat terrain to be launched. Aerostat has zero fuel consumption once deployed. It has a maximum endurance, which is quite a large one. Compared to 16 hours or so, it can be many, many days, up to a month sometimes. And it can be launched from any terrain. All it requires is a small ground, some small clear area, as you can see in the bottom. And that's it. That is enough for it to be launched. That is the comparison between aircraft and aerostat. But I am not saying that the aircraft on the right, F-16, is equal to the aerostat on the left. Okay, don't go by the pictures. This is just an indicative image. Then somebody says, why not use satellites? Because we have satellites already. Why to look at aerostats? Aerostats are very cost effective. They are portable. They can be easily relocated. They can be moved here and there. And also because they are at a lower altitude, they provide more detail compared to the satellites. Okay. Now, I'll just skip this. This is too detailed for you because you're not going to anyway work on aerostat right now. But some people think they are all very small systems. That is not true. They can actually be very, very large capability, up to 2.5 tons payload. Coverage of 600 kilometers can be given to you, and it can remain up in the air for a very long time. Applications of aerostats. It can be used for surveillance and communication, which is the most common usage. You can use them for local area surveillance. You can also, I remember there was a news about in Vadodara, there was an aerostat used for keeping an eye on the people during COVID-19, whether they are breaking the curfew. Okay. And then there are very interesting applications like aerodrome protection, etc. I'll skip all these details. I'll just show you some aerostat which we have developed recently for the government of Uttarakhand. So we developed an aerostat system for last mile communication. This was funded by an agency called as IT Development Agency of Uttarakhand, or ITDA, as you can see in the balloon on the top. This is a simple aerostat which comes with a oblate spheroid balloon and a sail on the back, which is something like a fin, but not as effective, but very, very simple. So this particular aerostat system, it was field tested at two locations. One testing was done in Ahmednagar for our own comfort and verification and validation. And then the final deployment was done in Dehradun. It's a day and night product. So we have certain LEDs mounted on board, which can be remotely switched so that we can conserve the battery. Because once you deploy the aerostat, you don't want to bring it down too much. You want to keep it as far as possible at the upper location. Okay. Right. Let me show you a trial video. It's a short video. Please confirm. Is it visible? I think there is a problem. So what I'll do is I'll stop the share. And I'll go directly to the folder where it is there so that it becomes visible to you. Just give me 1 minute, please. Okay, so I'm going to now show you. Please confirm that you can see the video. You can see the image, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to play the video.
Yes, sir.
So you can see this is a fast clip of inflation of the envelope and then deployment of the envelope. This is a weather station which gives us accurate data about the weather. Then we mount the antenna. This is the tether. These are some electronic equipment that we need, battery, etc., for communication and for controlling the LEDs on board. And you can see that we are deploying it. Here you can see. This is the next day morning after deployment. We kept it the whole night, and next day morning we were trying to have a look at how it looks. Along with the communication antenna that you can see, we also put a camera so that we can use it for aerial surveillance and communication. What you now see is a Wi-Fi antenna. There are three Wi-Fi antennae. Each can go for 120 degrees. And with this, you can get a 360 degree coverage. This particular system was formally inaugurated by the then Chief Minister of Uttarakhand. You can see that the system definitely responds to the winds. And this is a nighttime video that shows the working of the LED lights. We are bringing it down only to change the equipment. We don't have to bring it down otherwise. Once deployed, it can remain non-stop. Let me pause it here. So, can you see there is a weather station here with a small anemometer on the bottom that gives us the wind data. And you have a payload carrying basket here in which we mount whatever we want. And this antenna is mounted offset. Okay. This is a formal inauguration of the system by the then Chief Minister. That's it. He just presses a button and then the tether is released and it goes up. Aerial surveillance of the local domain. This is a system that was made by our people to monitor the health of this aerostat, and we can also use it during mild rain conditions. So this time we are mounting a police VHF antenna. With this police antenna, at a height of around 80-90 meters, we were able to communicate from Dehradun to Haridwar. And that was the best result we got for this communication system. So this is an example of an aerostat which can be deployed non-stop for a very long time. Our testing was for 1 week. And we brought it down only about 3 or 4 times just to reconfigure the system. Otherwise, it can just remain in the buoyancy non-stop. Okay? Right. So, going back to my presentation. So, these are the results. With the RF antenna, we could provide 2G, 3G, 4G data and voice communication over 2 kilometer radius. With the sector antenna, we could give Wi-Fi for 1 kilometer radius. Imagine if you put this in your college, the whole college can get a Wi-Fi connectivity within 1 kilometer radius. All the shops and the tapri nearby where you are sitting, you can get Wi-Fi there. And with the police, I mentioned to you that we can go for 60 kilometer radius. 60 kilometer radius of communication. Okay. So that's it. I would like to use the remaining few minutes to we will take a break after about 6 minutes at 10:50. But I would like you to ask any questions or any doubts that you may have regarding whatever you have seen so far before we go ahead. So doubts about LTA systems in general and about aerostats in particular. Don't ask questions about airships, but that we will cover next. Yes.
Sir, I wanted to ask you that Uttarakhand is having really very not good weather, right? So how can you use those systems in that area?
Right. Very good, Mahi. A good question. The thing is that no system is meant to be used at all places 24/7. With LTA systems, we anyway have a serious problem that you cannot deploy them under all weather conditions, especially if the wind is oscillating a lot. Okay. So, but with all that, there are definitely certain situations and locations where the wind patterns are not that bad, especially during early morning and late evening. So we wanted to do a demonstration and we wanted to say that if you give us a chance, we will try to deploy at other places and see how it performs. But what you say is right. This is not a solution for 24/7 communication. Only at specific times. When the weather is
permitted. Okay, sir.
When the weather permits. Yes. Any other question?
Yes, sir. I have one doubt. Do we need to employ any person on the ground where the aerostat is moved for checking on the systems that we are deploying in the air?
Okay, that's a very good question.
Yes, like in the control station, do we need any person or it is fully automatic?
No, right now we have made a control station where somebody has to sit. So remember one thing, that if you are deploying a system in the outdoor for a very long time, the weather conditions are not in your control and suddenly the weather can become very bad and disturbing. Okay. It's a day and night system. So what we recommend is that at least there should be one experienced and trained person always there at the control station. Why? Because in case the situation suddenly becomes very dangerous, we should have a mechanism to bring it down quickly. It could be remotely operated, or in worst case scenario, if suddenly things go very bad and the whole thing starts oscillating very wildly, we would like to trigger a system which can release the gas and lower the balloon safely, because the payload is very expensive and we don't want to damage that payload. So that's why currently we are recommending that at least one person should be there always whenever the system is deployed. But I understand your constraint that if you do that, then it becomes operationally very expensive and difficult. So the research and development can be that it can be remotely operated. There can be a camera fitted in the control station, which is giving a feed continuously, and someone remotely can also operate. But we have not done that so far.
Okay, sir.
Hello, sir.
Yes, yes.
Sir, can I ask what was the payload of communication payload weight with battery used in the Uttarakhand project?
In the Uttarakhand project, the communication payload was there were three, but the main one was there was a radio frequency cable with an omni antenna. So the antenna and fittings were around 4.5 kg, and the cable was around 22 kg. Okay, so it's around 30 kg payload. This aerostat could lift around 30 kg payload.
Okay, sir. And was helium gas used in it?
No, we have not used helium gas, because as I mentioned to you, helium is a very expensive gas and it is not easily available. It was going completely beyond our budget. So we have used hydrogen.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
But what we have done is a very smart thing. We have designed the aerostat assuming that helium will be used. But when you use hydrogen, you will get additional payload capacity, which can be taken care by ballasting, as I will talk to you. So it is designed to operate with helium, but we don't use helium unless the funding agency is able to afford the usage of helium.
Yes, sir.
Helium is going to be very expensive. It's going to be almost 10 times more expensive than hydrogen.
Sir.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, Janika,
Sir, in the project that you did, there were two white flaps that were attached. Can you please explain their role?
On the back side?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, because we are using an oblate spheroid envelope, we don't have the required lens to put any control surfaces because they will give very small moment arm. So, therefore, what we did in this case is we put a sail. A sail is basically a single piece of fabric mounted on the periphery of the aerostat on one side. What happens is that when there is wind, the sail gathers the wind like that on a ship, and it starts, minimizes the lateral oscillation of the aerostat. I'm saying minimizes because it cannot remove, but it can minimize. So it is meant for providing some amount of stability. If I put just an envelope, it is going to oscillate very badly. With a sail, it will remain inclined in one position to a large moment of time. Okay. So last question before we break up is by Kishan. Kishan, sorry, I had to interrupt
you. Yes, sir.
Go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sir, consider a hypothetical situation where there is a hot sunny day and there is a lot of load on the batteries. So, there can be a chance of battery blowing up, and also you have used hydrogen gas. So, what precautions did you take to control that blast?
Yes, very good question. If you noticed, we are not putting the battery in the exposed condition. We have put the battery in a small box which was made strong. And we ensured that the strength of the box is such, we put some tie rods around the box to ensure that even if the battery explodes for some reason, the flames don't reach. And also we mounted it at a sufficient distance below the envelope. Also remember one thing, that inside the envelope, the helium tends to go towards the, or the hydrogen tends to go towards the top of the envelope. Okay. So we have a double chamber envelope, and on the bottom, we have additional padding to isolate any instance of fire or any other thing hitting, even if there is a sharpener. So that's a very good question. In design, we have to take care of all these things. All right, friends. So what I will do is I'm going to now stop the meeting for about 8 minutes to take a short break. We are going to now reassemble at 11 o'clock. And at 11 o'clock, I will discuss about introduction to airships. Okay. So let us take a short bio break and come back at 11 o'clock. I will keep the meeting on. Actually, I am in two minds. So I'm going to stop the live.